Howdy everyone to another episode of Uniforms of the Screen. In this video, we'll be going over a uniform many people are familiar with. The uniform of those tiny little plastic soldiers, commonly referred to as plastic army men. We will specifically be looking at the one seen throughout the Toy Story series. So let's move out.
All right, men, you hurry!
Although tiny toy soldiers have been around for hundreds of years in one way, shape, or form, the introduction of plastic army men is still relatively new, as they began being seen on a massive scale around the 1950s. However, towards the 1960s and 70s, they gained something of a modern look, and since then the more recognizable figures are these guys here. With their appearance familiar to many, Toy Story ran with this look starting out of the gate in the original 1995 movie. From there, they would make brief appearances in Toy Story 2 and 3. So what is their uniform? Well, put simply, they're 2-inch injected molded plastic toys, and because of that, it would be impossible to identify, let alone wear their uniforms. And with that, we've reached the conclusion of another episode of Uniforms of the Screen. Be sure to subscribe or check back frequently for more videos right here on Uniform History. Oh, you're still here? Well, for those of you who stayed around, it's safe to say you figured out the joke, either by noticing the upload date of April 1st, or read some of the comments below. So if you're curious or want to know how to put this uniform together, keep on watching. This is going to be a little bit of a different style than usual, as it requires a bit of DIY know-how. Nothing crazy, but being that it's something of a made-up uniform, some work on your end will be required. We're going to start with what uniform pieces you'll need, then onto materials such as paint and all that fun stuff afterwards. So, back to the uniforms. Based on the looks of these plastic soldiers, they are US ones from somewhere around the late Vietnam War to mid-1980s. Starting literally at the top, we have the helmet, which appears to be the US M1. You can go the original metal route, or simply use a plastic liner from one. The plastic liners would actually work better because, well, these guys are plastic, so it'll look more accurate. Also because they're cheaper and won't weigh as much as issued ones. Next up are the jacket and pants. There are two uniforms you can go with depending on whether you want to go for the Toy Story look or the actual figures. In Toy Story, the jackets have 4 front pockets. Because of this, one could argue they're jungle fatigues. However, with the lack of slant breast pockets and shoulder straps, it's safe to say they are BDUs. Just keep in mind the pants for both versions have no side pockets. You're going to want to get a lighter color ripstop BDU, which will make it a lot more paint friendly when the time comes. As for the figures, they only have 2 breast pockets with V-shaped closures, which likely means they are based on the third type US OG-107 uniforms. For the undershirt, a basic white or green t-shirt is all that's needed. Although not seen on these figures, a good idea is to pick up a pair of gloves. The thinner and more form-fitting, the better. A good option would be some Nomex flight gloves. Or you could just paint your hands green. Around the waist appears to be a standard pistol belt. Being that these guys are very low in detail, you can make out just 3 elevated rectangles. So, this is sort of open to interpretation, but judging from the overall look of these figures and the 3 lines, the belt is more than likely the US M1956 canvas pistol belt. On it, you'll see different soldiers wearing different pouches and equipment. Again, because of the low quality, it's hard to determine exact pouch types, but based on the sizing and inspiration, we can source pieces that would fit the part. There appear to be 4 distinct items hanging from different soldiers' belts. These 4 items are a small pouch, just slightly wider than the belt. The closest real-life pouch would be the Field First Aid Dressing Unmounted Magnetic Compass Pouch. A medium-sized rectangular-shaped pouch, which is most likely the pouch made for the short M16 magazines. As these are rare in the M1956, your best bet would be the M1967 versions, which are a bit more common. A canteen and cover, which is likely the M1956 version because of its longer closure flaps. And finally, what appears to be a pistol holster, which hangs from the belt. The closest issue holster would be the US M1911 with an attached hanger. Again, these are just recommendations, as any pouch close to these shapes would work. Also, keep in mind canvas will paint better than nylon. Finally, to round things off, we have the boots. Although there are many different ways you can go about getting these boots, 2 good options are the standard nylon US jungle boots, which are very cheap and common, or really any leather lace-up combat boots. So that covers it for the uniform. As far as weapons and gear, though, there are six main pieces. The standard Colt M16A1 with its M7 bayonet, the M2 mortar, the M67 recoilless rifle, aka the bazooka, the minesweeper, which is likely the World War II SCR-625 mine detector because of the rounded end, an M1911 pistol, and a pair of M19 binoculars. Once again, these are likely the inspiration for the gear used. Your best bet would be replicas or plastic toy versions. There are probably even some DIY tutorials to make homemade versions out there. We'll put links to some we found in the description below. Now, lastly, we have the paratroopers. The only difference with these guys are the inclusion of a ring on the helmet to attach them to their parachutes. To do this, simply get a large plastic ring, 5 inches or larger should do, cut a section, and affix it to the helmet with hot or super glue. Lastly, in the movie, they wear it folded up and attached to their body with a rubber band. To do this, you can get a cheap full-size parachute if you wanted, or just get some white string, tie one end to the helmet ring and the other to a large plastic painter's tarp. Fold it up and tie it around yourself. Okay, now that we've covered the uniform pieces, let's move on to the modifications and preparations. For your face, there are two options, face paint or a mask. To really give the full plastic face effect, you'll want to get a plastic face mask. Sometimes referred to as Koe masks, these are popular for airsoft and come in a variety of colors. Either way you go, supplement it with a veil or hood. If you wanted to go the extra mile for an all-authentic look, you'll want to remember the residual signs of the mold-making process, which are the circles seen on the back of the helmet and torso, as well as the small flaps of plastic seen along the edges of the arms and legs, which are a result of plastic seeping between the gaps in the mold halves. If you wanted to replicate these, you can take small pieces of plastic, cardboard, or cloth, cut them straight on the side that attaches to the uniform and randomly on the outward-facing side, then attach them accordingly. Finally, one of the most important features is the base plate. There seems to be two options one can do. The first is to make a one-piece board that's not attached and you simply stand on it when needed. The other is to take the board and split it in two, then attach one half to each boot so you can walk around. Alright, once all that's done, take everything you have, make sure they're clean of any dirt, dust, or debris, then lightly sand with fine grit sandpaper any and all plastic pieces. This will help the paint adhere to them. Okay, painting time. First things first, you want to make sure to put a base coat of primer over everything. The shade of green you want to go is up to you, but one of the closest colors out there is Rust-Oleum's Meadow Green. Depending on where you live, Rust-Oleum may not be available. So look for something close to a light forest green. Regardless of brand or color, be sure to once again get high gloss for that shiny finish, which gives the impression of plastic. Keep in mind, clothing will get a bit stiff with spray paint, and certain fabrics don't react too well to it. If it comes out a little on the matte side, just get some gloss finish spray and touch it up. If for whatever reason you want to go as a tan soldier or blue soldier or pink, orange, or whatever color, just follow the same directions but with the color you choose. Once everything's dry and you're good to go, be sure to cover any exposed skin with face paint that's close to the color you chose. So there we have it, perhaps the most ridiculous episode of Uniforms of the Screen. For those who were curious and stuck around, for real this time, hope you enjoyed the pseudo joke, and for those who actually wanted to learn and or put this uniform together, hopefully this helped out a little bit. Being that a few of these bits of info and steps weren't exactly follow the link and purchase the item like in our previous videos, we hope the directions were clear, educational, and put people actually wanting to make this on the right path towards achieving that goal. We'll be doing a few more of these every now and again, both in a broad sense like this and in a finer step-by-step detail sort of way, so keep an eye out for those. Once again, as always, be sure to subscribe or check back frequently for more videos right here on Uniform History. Thank you.